Welcome to St. George's Chapel and this special service to give thanks for the 80th birthday of Her Majesty the Queen. And it's particularly fitting that we're here on St. George's Day, because St. George is not just the patron saint of England, he is also the patron saint of the Order of the Garter, which has its spiritual home here in this chapel.
Since the Middle Ages, it has been the practice to place a helmet, sword and banner over the stall of each Knight of the Garter, and the ornate choir still has a medieval feel. It's traditional to announce new Knights of the Garter on St. George's Day each year, and today the Queen's youngest sons, the Duke of York and the Earl of Wessex, have become the newest members of this historic and noble order. Today's service, marking the Queen's 80th birthday, was always going to be a straightforward one, none of the pomp and circumstance of a state occasion, but more or less the usual Matins service that takes place here each Sunday. Rather than the choir, the service was to be conducted in the nave of the chapel. Not an unprecedented move for a royal occasion, but certainly a more informal setting. The doors were opened just before 10 this morning, and soon the nave was full of the specially invited guests. The Right Honourable Sir John Major, accompanied by his wife Norma, the Earl Spencer and the Countess Spencer, the Queen's godson, brother of course of Diana, Princess of Wales, former Prime Minister Baroness Thatcher, invited today as a Lady of the Order of the Garter. And here, Her Majesty the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh, being greeted there by the Dean of Windsor, the Right Reverend David Connor, and taken through the Galilee porch. The Prince of Wales and the Duchess of Cornwall arriving to take their seats, and Prince Harry and Prince William. Prince Andrew there, the Duke of York, who has been announced today as a new Knight of the Garter. And now through the choir, the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh are led by the Dean of Windsor. The choir stalls fill today with members of the community who live inside Windsor Castle, some of the wives of the military knights, many of the people who live and work here. Queen dressed today in an outfit designed by one of her favorite designers, Stuart Parvin, who himself is one of the invited guests today. The first hymn, Through All the Changing Scenes of Life, chosen to reflect the changing of the seasons, the long reign of Her Majesty the Queen.
Thank you. We are gathered together today to offer our Sunday worship to Almighty God during this Eastertide. Most especially on this festival of St. George, we render thanksgiving for God's merciful goodness shown to our nation both now and through the past centuries. In particular, we express our gratitude that our Heavenly Father has preserved to us Elizabeth, our Queen. We pray that she will long continue to inspire her people to walk by the ways of faith and truth, so we may come to share one heart and mind in the service of the common good.
The praises are sung by the Reverend Alan Guile and the choir.
O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouths shall show thy praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to save us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, ever shall be.
The choir sings Psalm 67. The first lesson is read by the Reverend Canon Dr. Houston Finley, steward of the college.
Here beginneth the book of Joshua. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, "My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the Israelites. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, as I promised to Moses. From the wilderness and the Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, to the great sea in the west, shall be your territory. No one shall be able to stand against you in all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land that I swore to their ancestors to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to act in accordance with the law that my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, so that you may be successful wherever you go. The book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful. I hereby command you, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Here endeth the first lesson.
The choir sings Jubilate Deo, led by the director of music at St. George's Chapel, Timothy Byram-Wigfield.
Thank you.
second lesson is read by the Reverend Canon John Ovenden, chaplain of the college.
Here beginneth the sixth chapter of the letter to the Ephesians. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak. Here endeth the lesson.
Now a new anthem, The Golden Rule, composed as a birthday tribute to the Queen. The words written by the poet laureate, Andrew Motion, the music by the master of the Queen's music, Sir Peter Maxwell Davis.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, which art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
O Lord, show thy mercy upon us.
And grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, save the Queen.
And mercifully hear us when we call upon thee.
And you, thy ministers, with righteousness.
And make the chosen be joyful.
O Lord, save thy people.
And bless thy inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord. God, make clean our hearts within us.
And take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
Almighty Father, who has given thine only Son to die for our sins and to rise again for our justification, grant us so to put away the leaven of malice and wickedness, that we may always serve thee in pureness of living and truth. Through the merits of the same thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O God of hosts, who didst so kindle the flame of love in the heart of thy servant George, that he bore witness to the risen Lord by his life and by his death, grant us the same faith and power of love, that we who rejoice in his triumphs may come to share with him the fullness of the resurrection. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
The congregation stand for the hymn, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. The sermon given by the Dean of Windsor.
We've come together in St. George's Chapel, Windsor Castle, on St. George's Day, the day on which we especially remember one of our nation's patron saints. His story is, of course, the story of a man who struggled with great courage to champion the good. And like so many archetypal stories of that ilk, seems often to awaken the imagination, be felt as challenge and as inspiration. Whether or not we give our allegiance to any recognizable religion, it does seem to be the case that deep within us there stirs an impulse, a spiritual impulse, some would say, to champion the good, to rise above crude selfishness, to lose ourselves in love of neighbour, and thereby discover true humanity. On this particular St. George's Day, in St. George's Chapel, family and friends and neighbours have gathered to join in thanksgiving for the birthday of our Queen. As we do so, I have a hunch that every one of us will be expressing gratitude for some kind of encouragement received as we have tried in our ordinary lives to be decent and to care. Your Majesty, not so much through word as by unself-conscious good example, you encourage us, you give us heart. That encouragement comes to us, of course, in different ways. Certainly, it's given through the example of service freely offered, of endurance, discipline, steadfastness, and stamina in meeting the demands of duty, and of a sort of modesty which I think would always rather that someone else were centre of attention. In an age when we are maybe tempted to worry too much about ourselves, you help us understand that happiness, fulfilment, and humanity can be gleaned from self-forgetfulness. And in a world in which we often feel confused and buffeted by so many changes, some of which seem to be only for the sake of change itself, your provision of a sense of continuity through your office, and perhaps much more important, ma'am, your conveying of a sense of calmness, serenity, and stillness through your person, help us to understand that real human beings need to be deeply rooted if they are to flourish. This too is encouragement to us as we respond to that impulse to try to do and be our best. Then, of course, there is your sense of family, not only seen in your abiding loyalty to and love for those who are closest to you, but seen also in that enthusiasm to embrace as one family a diversity of people in this nation and in the Commonwealth. When the danger sometimes seems that we shall all go our separate ways, you have given us the heart to believe that for all our differences and faults and failings, as human beings, in so many ways and at so many levels, we belong together. We need each other. I spoke at the beginning of a spiritual impulse deep within us, a desire perhaps to live life in the light of love. It seems to have been the very life pulse of that genuinely human person, Jesus Christ. His resurrection, which we celebrate at Eastertide, is a promise that it will never be extinguished, and that in the end, and in all things, love will triumph. In our ordinary lives, our small attempts to make the world a kinder place for all to live in have deep significance, are part of a greater pattern. Your Majesty, this Christian faith, which can inspire in us confidence and hope, is the very bedrock of your life. This belief that we are in the safe hands of the God of love is the well from which each day you draw the strength to give us heart. For that we praise Almighty God, give you heartfelt thanks and much affection, and promise you our prayers through all the years ahead.
The Dean of Windsor expressing a very deep gratitude to the Queen in his thanksgiving for her 80th birthday. And now the final hymn, Thine Be the Glory. Prayers are led by the Reverend Canon John White.
As we join Her Majesty the Queen in giving thanks to Almighty God for his loving kindness made known to us new every morning all the days of our life. We pray especially at this time of her birthday celebrations for the Queen and for all members of the royal family. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have preserved to us Elizabeth, our Queen, and given her throughout her days the many blessings of faith, hope, and love. Continue to surround her with your mercies, that she may receive the gifts she needs to fulfill her duties as our sovereign. Protect and support all the members of her family, and grant that by their service, peace and justice may flourish among her people, and integrity and truth become the ensigns of our common life. On this our earthly pilgrimage, so assist us with your grace, that together we may share the joys of your eternal kingdom, for the praise and honor of your holy name. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Now, O Hearken Thou, which was sung at the 1937 coronation of the Queen's father, King George VI. The Dean of Windsor will give the blessing.
May God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us the victory, give you joy and peace in your faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
today's family service to mark the Queen's 80th birthday draws to a close. The military knights, led by their governor, Michael Hobbs, make their way to the west doors. The Military Knights of Windsor, who claim to be the oldest military establishment in the army list. All retired army officers. Military knights followed there by the choir and minor canons. The procession making its way out through the west doors, where they will line the west steps as the royal family comes out of the nave. The Dean of Windsor escorts the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh. And the Canons of Windsor escort the rest of the royal family. Prince Charles and the Duchess of Cornwall there, who just over a year ago had a service of prayer and dedication here in St. George's Chapel. And so the Queen makes her way down the west steps outside St. George's Chapel. This family service today, very much a culmination of 5 days of public and private celebrations to mark the Queen's 80th birthday. One of the high points of which must have been the Queen's walkabout last Friday in front of so many thousands of well-wishers here in Windsor. This, perhaps the first chance we have had in the last few days to see the Queen surrounded by her entire family, the royal family who have very much stood back this week to ensure that the focus was entirely on the Queen. Prince Charles, the Duchess of Cornwall, chatting there to the Dean of Windsor, who led that service of prayer and dedication last April in St. George's Chapel following their wedding. Now the Queen makes her way down the west steps to the awaiting car, which will take her back inside Windsor Castle and the reception that is being held there for her family and all those specially invited guests. But the celebrations will begin again in June with a series of planned events to mark the Queen's official birthday on June the 17th. From all of us here inside Windsor Castle, goodbye.